human perfection. Pike gives us innumerable references to this and builds much of his symbolism upon the conviction that this is the basis. That without the true knowledge of the fire, man labors in vain. And that this fire, therefore, belongs peculiarly and wonderfully to the central core mystery of being. That man began as the spark from the flame. That man actually first raised his altars to the fire. And whether he outwardly and intellectually knew it or not, he was stating the nearest thing to absolute truth that he was able to conceive at that time. And ever since then, he has been taking something away from it. He has never added to it, because he chose in the beginning perhaps the truest symbol that he could possibly have devised. Therefore, says Pike, we now have not simply a central geographical region surrounded by a group of peoples. We have a central psychographical quality represented now by the ever-burning fire. The fire which, according to legend, has never failed, even though historically perhaps it has. But this fire is now surrounded by a series of other fires that have been lighted by its torch. And wherever this fire springs up, it seems to tell us that the one torch lit it. And this circumference of fires, gradually spreading on and on, like the mysterious campfires in the sky of the ancient Sioux warrior waiting for death, these fires going on have created roads or paths, because the way they traveled becomes a road for anyone who wishes to travel back. Consequently, in all parts of the world, there is pilgrimage. Pilgrimage back to the father fountains, back to the parent fire. And around the fire is a wall, a great structure to protect the holy place, like the strange walls around the tabernacle in the wilderness. Walls have been built to guard the sanctuary, that the profane may not enter. And these walls, in Pike's thinking, are the walls of faiths. That they are not actually enemies of the fire. They are guardians. They stand almost like armed cherubs, guarding the 12 gates to the holy land of truth. And these cherubs with flaming swords will not permit the uninitiated to enter into the sacred ground. Therefore, these religions have gradually become systems of discipline. They have become ways of purification. They have become the pronaos of the temple, the outer part, the porch. And no one can enter the sanctuary who does not first pass through the porch, to be challenged by the guardians like those who entered the ancient Egyptian mysteries. And unless they have the right word, unless they are able to prove their fitness to go on, the door does not open, and they remain outside. Only those who are permitted to pass these gates have right of entry. Pike points out in 1878 that it's a little a pity that religions have not recognized this very significant point, that they, like the flaming cherubs, are the guardians of something superior to them all, and that therefore this idle controversy as to which one is the holiest among them is one of the worst wastes of time in history, and furthermore, the greatest cause of cruelty perhaps the world has ever known. That in attempting to vie with each other, they have forgotten that they were created to stand guard. They were created as gates, leading not to themselves, but through themselves, to that which was the substance of them all. that discovering this substance, that man was then, perhaps more than ever before, capable of being grateful to the paths that he had walked. One of the Eastern teachers once said that any good disciple can outgrow his master, but that he can never outgrow the gratitude that he owes his master. And those that teach us along the way, the great gates through which we pass, we may pass through them. But if each of these sanctuaries has been a good and faithful servant of the Eternal, we shall ever be grateful that it stands. And though we may pass into other things, we shall still defend it with a whole heart and feel the nobility and significance of the purpose which it serves. If, however, we accept each of these gates as the substance rather than the shadow of the substance, and become hopelessly involved in each as a separate thing, the great blazing altar of the real goes unattended. A man has not achieved the great identity of his own spiritual aspiration. So these gates become the natural doors, the mysterious 12 gates in the city of the New Jerusalem. And through these gates men can move. But these gates are each of them marked with tests, with trials, with obligations. And these obligations are not, as we have been told or have been taught to think, that they are not the arbitrary dictates of a deity who tells us that we must go hungry when we want to eat, or that we must be miserable in order to be virtuous. That is not the concept at all. These trials exist for only one purpose, namely that they represent the undergraduate work in the University of Truth. We have to face them as such. The trial is given to us not because we are sinners or we are born in sin and conceived in iniquity. The trial is given to us because we are truth seekers. And in order to achieve the truth we seek, we must become the truth we seek. Therefore, these tests, these trials, these disciplines are absolutely indispensable to those who would approach the flame. For if those who approach the flame are not so disciplined, so that the dross in their own natures has not been voluntarily removed, then they approach the flame with combustible material and will find not the light of ages, but a consuming fire, because the dross cannot survive the flame. Therefore, it is the duty of man to remove the dross before he approaches the flame. If not, the experience is painful rather than helpful. So ethics represents merely the outer shadow, the exoteric name for discipline. Men do not do these things for the benefit of each other. They do not do these things primarily, actually, for the benefit of themselves as persons. They do these things in the name of and in the cause of the truth, without which they cannot live or survive. So Pike points out that in his estimation, that circle of ancient guardians actually existed. And by degrees, through the passing of time, we have forgotten that they were indeed a circle guarding a sacred place. And because that thing which was in the center of that place was not a vast cathedral built by men, was not a wonderful holy city leaving 10 layers of ruin for us to excavate, but because that thing in the center was mostly life, pure life, it was easy to forget it, because we couldn't see anything with our objective senses. We could not sense the magnitude unless we achieved it. Thus, the center gradually ceased to exist as far as we are concerned. our own ignorance caused us to miss the implication entirely. And we began to make each of these gates centers in themselves. And we had many centers, therefore many faiths, rather than many gates to one. Then, of course, followed the general confusion of tongues, confusion of minds, and confusion of souls, and it became possible for men to kill each other in the name of God. It became possible for them to persecute each other in the name of truth, because the center was gone. And without that center, each thing standing by itself alone was inadequate, unreal, imperfect. The loss of the consciousness of the center made it possible for us to be fanatics, made it possible for us to be bigots. Whereas the realization of that center would have preserved the great and magnificent geometrical harmony of the divine plan. Having missed the point, we did not, however, miss it without some redeeming factors as we realized it, because these gates were originally created with the correct purpose. Pike is convinced that they were. And he is also convinced that these gates, when in the course of ages a faith failed or a religion ceased, and therefore a gate was left untended, that immediately out of the structure of the general pattern, new gatekeepers came, who were also to remain the custodians of these gates. Therefore, all religions were not founded at exactly the same time as separate sects. They might be founded over a period of 20,000 years. Yet still, actually, they are those gates. And the gate factor itself never changes. Having recognized that all existing faiths were either founded upon the original plan or founded by branching from those who were part of the original plan, that a strange, semi-lost continuity has continued, and that the old mystery temples, which flourished as late in the Near East and in the Mediterranean areas as the 3rd and 4th and 5th centuries of the Christian era, that these mystery temples were aware, at least in part, of their kinship with the ancient roots. Furthermore, these older temples did keep a certain roadway open between themselves. And from the travels of Pythagoras, and later of Apollonius Tyanus, and other of the great initiates of the period, we know that these persons traveled from one of these great centers to another with adequate passports, that they traveled as persons known and expected. When Apollonius reached the northern parts of the Ganges River, the headwaters of the Ganges, he found there the Indian teachers waiting for him, already aware that he was coming. Now, some may say, perhaps they were just clairvoyant. Perhaps they were. But it was at least one point. He came not as a stranger, but as one expected and awaited, and one welcomed. In those days, this relationship between these groups was not hopelessly lost. They had not become creed-bound. They had not said, my God against thy God. Or they already had achieved and had maintained, as Pythagoras tells us, the realization that in all the various areas that he visited, and he visited over 20 of the great religious systems of Europe, the Near East, the Far East, and North Africa, that they all taught the same doctrine and they all knew it. And that was as late as 550 BC. They knew it. And yet, in these intervening 2400 years, this knowledge has been generally lost. So we have an interesting evidence that knowledge has gotten lost even after history has been able to record it. Pike is therefore convinced and I think he has a very strong story in his behalf, that this knowledge of being waves leading in to this great central fire core, this knowledge existed, probably generally known, as late as Plato and Socrates, perhaps a little later. Less generally, but somewhat widely known, as late as the 6th century A.D. Still known in some areas to the present time, but comparatively unknown to what we call Western culture. That this factor is known in Asia and in North Africa, I have reason to believe. I discussed some of these problems with some very learned Copts in Cairo, and they assured me that these facts were fully known to them. But these peripheral groups, almost untouched by the rapid so-called progress of the Western way of life, these are not listened to anymore, any more than are a few of the learned Sufis and dervishes who also know, nor certain of the very learned Taoists and Zen monks who also know. These things are not totally unknown. They are totally ignored by the majority of Western peoples. But the concept leads into the next important point, and that is that from the ancient mysteries, we have by natural heritage, as Pike points out, in incorporating part of this ritualism and symbolism into the Scottish degrees of Freemasonry, Pike points out that into this modern knowledge, and we can read it in Iamblichus on the Mysteries, in Proclus on the Theology of Plato, in the Eleusinian and Bacchic Mysteries, the Mysteries of Mithras, and many others, that these rituals are what we might term the gates, are still known. That there is this gate, a doctrine of awareness, the Zen concept of the mystery of the gateless gate. That this gate knowledge is still available. And Pike points out that it will always remain the same. In one generation it may be forgotten and another remembered. Perhaps sometime Vishnu must be born again to bring the law out of the depths of the ocean where it had been stolen away by giants. But regardless of what happens to the law remains. And man must come finally to the old road that leads to the law. And these ancient institutions, the mysteries, gradually bestowed part of their insight, but only a part, upon the rising theological systems that succeeded them in most areas. But each time this transmission was made, something was obscured by a heavier layer of symbols, until it became less and less easy to see the facts. But Pike points out that once you possess the key, not necessarily the great key that unlocks all truths, but now merely the point of view, which is the key, the discrimination to recognize landmarks, as some of the Freemasonic brethren call them, if we can see and recognize the landmarks, we will recognize the fact that no faith has ever been without them. We can also recognize that in every generation, in every religion, a few have recognized them and have quietly gone into this quiet search along the mysterious thread of Ariadne that led out of the labyrinth of confusion into the broad light of common sense. Out of all this consideration, then, Pike tells us, the essential remains. The mysteries, as we knew them then, have mostly fallen ruined in time. They have, however, bestowed themselves as moral forces and as intangible but real values upon those things that succeeded them. And these, in turn, have, in one way or another, perpetuated, often without knowing it, certain peculiar doctrines, certain particular arrangement of emblems and patterns, whether in music, in art, in literature, or architecture, or scripture, science, philosophy, religion. These different groups have all perpetuated the key. The only problem is to find it, to get it out again. And the key, there's always the road that leads to the gate, and at the gate, through the mystery of initiation, supplies the pass sign, by means of which the individual can pass into the ancient temple, where he can come finally into the sanctum sanctorum, or the adytum of the house, the great central place in which stands alone the flaming symbol of the eternal. Thus the search is for this, and Pike, being a scholar in these things and a great researcher, realizes that the secret societies of the ancients were therefore the elementary schools, so to say, leading into this knowledge, that their primary